أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم الذين يتبعون الرسول النبي الأمي الذي يجدونه مكتوبا عندهم في التوراة والإنجيل يأمرهم بالمعروف وينهاهم عن المنكر ويحل لهم الطيبات ويحرم عليهم الخبائث ويضع عنهم إصرهم والأغلال التي كانت عليهم فالذين آمنوا به وعزروه ونصروه واتبعوا النور الذي أنزل معه أولئك هم المفلحون اللهم اجعلنا من المفلحين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله أمين يا رب العالمين. I want to start my khutbah with something very simple. I think something everybody here understands. That as people that live in society, we can't help but feel pressure from society. And when that is said, societal pressure, we usually think of bigger things. But really, it boils down to even the most microscopic details in our life. Those of you that have children will notice your children want a certain toy. And more than anything else, sometimes they want that toy because someone else at school has it. They want to get what somebody else has. That's a form of societal pressure. Your children start getting a little bit older and they want to dress a certain way. And the idea of them wanting to dress that certain way didn't come from their own imagination. It came from something they saw on TV that was defined to them as the way to dress. Or someone they saw dressed that way at school and is popular. And that sort of becomes the defining thing for them. And they want to dress that way or look that way or buy that gadget or have a phone. Little kids wanting to have a phone, right? What do you need a phone for? I don't know, my friends have it too. Why can't I have it? You probably, parents have heard that logic before. They have it, why can't I have it? When you get a little bit older, the same societal pressure, it takes different forms. It could be something as simple as you parking your car at your office in the parking lot and your coworker has a nicer car and you go, man, I need to get ahead. Look at what these guys are driving. You know, the neighborhood you live in, and you go visit one of your friend's house who lives in a nicer neighborhood, and the thought is running in your mind, man, when am I going to get to this point? I need to be where this guy is at or better. We're always comparing ourselves to what other people have. And we're constantly vying, consciously or subconsciously, to get what other people have also. This is what I mean by societal pressure. Whether it comes in the form of you dressing, or it comes in the form of what you purchase, where you put your money, what kind of career you want to pursue. A lot of times our parents, they give in to societal pressure. So whether their children are made for that or not, they will make sure they say to their children, you better become a medical doctor. Because if you don't, you're a failure at life. Everybody else around us that are successful, they're all doctors. So that's the only thing in life to do. And I'm not saying being a physician is a bad practice. But if your son or daughter becomes a doctor and they did not want to be, I would never want to be their patient. I wouldn't want to go to them. If the only reason they chose this profession is because their parents forced them to. Or because of some kind of societal pressure. These are pressures that exist all around us. This comparison stuff is all around us. And it can become so strong that a person can almost feel enslaved. They're not even free anymore. Which is really ironic that we're living in a society that prides itself over being free, right? It prides itself over having independent freedom. I can do whatever I want, dress however I want, talk however I want, you know, look however I want, spend my money on whatever I want. That's the thing that makes this society take pride in itself. And yet, if you go to somewhere as simple as high school, you'll find a bunch of kids that are dressed almost exactly the same. They're just almost exactly the same. All the hip-hop kids, they look the same. All the goth kids look the same. All the emo kids look the same. It's almost like they go through a uniform. And even the way they talk has to be a certain way to fit in with that crowd. And if you don't fit in with that crowd, then you're an outcast. And so when you look at that, I don't see freedom when I see that. What I see is cultural slavery. This young man or this young woman can't even make that decision of how to look or how to talk or how to walk for themselves. They have to conform to what is going on around them. And sometimes it's willing, sometimes you submit that is the better way to live. That is the better way to dress or to talk. Or that's the better thing to do with my time. That's the kind of music I want to be addicted to. Or these are the kinds of practices I'll do. Whatever, that's one conscious decision a person makes, that's the life to live. And sometimes it's even pressured. I've met Muslim teenage kids that have come to me in private, and when you look at them, you're like, man, is this guy in a gang or something? And they'll come to you in private and they'll be crying because they say, I don't want to dress like this. I don't want to look like this. But if I don't, I'll get beat up at school. That's cultural slavery. That's a form of slavery. But it's not just about the youth. And they're, you know, whether they become enslaved to musical culture or entertainment culture, and they want to be just like whatever, you know, that famous athlete or musician or actor is. It's beyond that. It's even for older generations. For our older generations, this kind of cultural slavery takes a different texture. It takes a different tone. You did things a certain way in your country or in your society. You saw that your entire life. You want to make sure your family and your children will do things exactly the same way. Whether that's good for them or not doesn't matter. This is how we do things. This is how it has to be done. And we're enslaved to certain definitions. In that context, what I want to share with you, first and foremost, is a very powerful ayah about the role of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of the functions of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam that is described in Surah Al-A'raf. Even though my khutbah today is not about this ayah. My khutbah today is about a couple of ayat from Surah Al-Baqarah. But I want to start with this ayah from Surah Al-A'raf.